homeless outcast called crazy and possessed. This is Jesus, another hopeless rebel, mocked and beaten, hung on a cross to die. This is Jesus, another lifeless body, stuffed into a borrowed tomb, soon to be forgotten. Is this really Jesus? Wake up. Wake up, O sleeper, and rise from the dead. This is Jesus, sent by the Father to be crushed for the sins of the world. This is Jesus, declaring to all he would be killed and then raised to life on the third day. This is Jesus, healing the sick, casting out demons, raising the dead. This is Jesus, a missing body from an empty tomb on a Sunday morning. This is Jesus, the image of invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, the Lamb of God, the light of the world. This is Jesus, Savior, Lord, King, Alpha, Omega, Creator, Redeemer, Friend to sinners, Hope of nations, the Messiah. This is Jesus, the resurrection and the life for all who trust in him. Wake up. Wake up, O sleeper, and rise from the dead. This is Jesus.
He is risen, and he is risen indeed. Let's stand up and worship together this morning. For our God is risen. Lord, we are here to celebrate you, Lord. May you receive our praises this morning. May you receive our praise, oh God. The tomb is empty. He is alive. Let's worship him together.
Hallelujah. Oh.
power that is in you is us this morning. So we're just here to celebrate you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Church, let's just clap hands for Jesus this morning. A beautiful day it is. We celebrate the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And church, may I just encourage you that as we continue with our worship, if the Lord gives you a word this morning, please do not hold back, but come share with Bervin, Pastor Kurt, and Paulette, so we all get to hear what the Lord is saying. Because God is always saying something. Just turn to your neighbor this morning and tell them, He is risen. He is alive. He conquered the grave. That's why we celebrate Him this morning. Let's give the Lord a big clap of praise. A big shout of praise. Come, Holy Spirit, move among us. Let's welcome the Holy Spirit this morning with a wave of hands. God, we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're here with us this morning. Touch us. We're hungry and yearning for more of you this morning.
Lord, call, Lord, call, Lord, Spirit, move among us. Come, Holy Spirit, flow living water, flow within us, flow living water.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are our friend. You are our comforter. And we invite you, Holy Spirit, in those dark places, Lord, because you bring light. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, we invite you in our lives, Lord, where there is shame. We thank you, Lord, that you're giving us love and grace. So Holy Spirit, penetrate through us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Even those hurts that we've held on for years, Lord, we just invite you, Holy Spirit. We invite you, Holy Spirit. Your word says when we receive, the Holy Spirit will also receive power. So we thank you, Lord, for that power that is found as we receive the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, we invite you to move amongst us. Speak to us, Holy Spirit, we invite you. As we just take a moment, church, let's just be quiet before the Lord. And let's just hear what the Holy Spirit is saying. He might be saying something to you individually, as a family, as a church. So let's just wait on the Lord. And just Holy Spirit, speak to us. For a moment, just open your ears and hear what the Holy Spirit is saying. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the healing that is taking place right now in this place, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the pain that you are taking from us this morning, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Just sense that there's healing that is going on right now. The Lord is just healing us, healing bodies, healing our souls as well. And I just pray that let's receive that healing and let's thank the Lord for the healing. Let's just thank him in your own words. Just open your mouth and thank him for the healing that is going on, the healing that is taking place right now. Healing of headaches, healing of backaches. We receive your healing, healing of hearts. We receive your healing, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, God. Healing of minds. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Church, let's bless the Lord as we receive our healing this morning. Forever he is glorified. Forever he is glorified. We glorify you, Jesus. Thank you.
The Savior of the world was fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Heaven looked away. the Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, his perfect love could not.
We sing hallelujah. We honor you. We honor you and we bless you this morning, Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness. And this morning, we just remember your faithfulness, oh God. We remember your wonderfulness. We acknowledge what you did, yes, on the cross. But this morning, we gather together just to remember how you rose from the dead, fulfilling your promise, fulfilling what you spoke to us, what you promised to us, that you will never leave us nor forsake us. And we recognize this morning that indeed you are alive. We give you all the glory. We give you all the praise in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Saints, you may take your seats. And as you do so, I just want to encourage each one of us to remain in that place of worship as we continue to glorify the Lord, to recognize His presence in this place. We acknowledge that the Lord has done so much for us. And maybe for some of you, you might be asking the question that the psalmist in Psalm 116 asked in verse 12. Psalm 116 in verse 12. The psalmist asked this question, "What shall I render to the Lord for all His benefits toward me?" We recognize that He is alive this morning. And we recognize that we are alive because of Him. The gift of life that we have is a benefit from our Lord. But the question is, what shall we render to the Lord for all His benefits? The psalmist answered himself in verse 13 and 14. He said, "I'll take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I'll pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all His people." And in verse 17, he said, "I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving, and I'll call upon the name of the Lord." And I just want to encourage each one of us that as we continue to worship the Lord, as we continue to honor Him, to express our love to Him, to thank Him for what He has done for us, let's worship Him with the sacrifice of our lips, thanking Him and saying, "Thank you, Jesus." But let's also consider to worship Him and to express our love towards Him as we give our offerings and tithes to Him, because it's all part of how we express worship to the Lord. So if you've been asking that question, what shall I render to the Lord for His benefits? The answer is worship Him. Worship Him in song and worship Him in your giving. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us. The opportunity to come before you, to experience your presence, to sing unto you, to have access to sing to you and to give to you. We recognize that you expressed your love to us by giving your only begotten Son. And we want to express our love this morning as we give unto you, as we express our love to you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, may you receive our worship this morning in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Thank you.
heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing that you wear the victor's crown. You're my help and my defender. You're my savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this temple. Let your power overflow. By your grace I live and breathe to worship.
Cheers. Oh, my family, did I not come for you? I have not forgotten you. You are the love of my life. I have loved you all the days of your life and will love you for all the rest of your days and for all eternity. Family, I call to you. Embrace my love, my joy, my peace, for it is yours for the taking. Love my people, love your families, love even those who hurt you, and do this in remembrance of me, for this is the greatest command of all, and indeed, true love. Oh, turn your hearts towards me, family. Wait not another day. How I love you. How I love you.
Heavenly Father, we embrace your love. We embrace your peace. We embrace your joy, Lord. Thank you for your love. And Lord, we thank you that you're encouraging us to share that love, Father. So we take and make a commitment that we are going to share your love, because your love is unconditional, because your love is so pure. We thank you, God, and we just embrace your love. In the name of Jesus, we glorify you. Let's just glorify the Lord as we embrace his love, we embrace his peace, we embrace his joy.
Amen and amen. In the book of Hebrews, scripture tells us that those who come to the Lord must believe that he is. And this morning, it's my pleasure to announce that he is alive. Amen. He is alive. Amen. We thank God for the blessing of this day. And as we're talking about Hebrews, say Hebrews, I'd like to just announce that, as a reminder, that we now have our coffee shop open. You know, we are very scriptural. Hebrews, he does, bro. So we have coffee being served by the veranda and the rooftop as we celebrate that Jesus is alive. Let's have time together to fellowship and just glorify the Lord. Amen. Now, we have an announcement for Children's Church that we want to put up. So if I can just encourage you to watch the announcement on the screen.
Hello, Pottersville family.
We're back and so excited to share the year with all of you. This year, as we pursue God first, we would like to invite you to come and join us at Children's Church and the Toddlers Bible Class as we lead our children in discovering what it means to know God and having a relationship with him.
We would also like to invite you to become a part of our Sunday services in the morning from 8:30 a.m. for the first service and 11 a.m. for the second service. We would love to have you come and be a part of us as we serve the children. It's always a great time of fellowship, praise and worship, and learning about the Word of God in fun and engaging ways that really minister to the Spirit. It's an experience you don't want to miss.
The harvest is truly plenty, but the laborers are few. So we would like to invite you to come and help us. This ministry is important for the future of the church. If you're interested, please use the details on the screen to contact us. You matter. Your presence matters. Partner with us in shaping the future of our next generation in the ways of the Lord, so that when they are old, they will not depart. Our doors are open and our hearts eagerly anticipate your arrival. Let's get better together.
From us to you, we pray that the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you as you follow him. And as we say in Children's Church, be blessed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Good day, Pottersville family. My name is John Hamilton, and I've been volunteering with Children's Church for the last few years. I'm serving as a small group leader, and I would like to encourage the men in the church to volunteer to be part of this dynamic and growing ministry. It has been a very rewarding experience for me, and seeing the children grow in their faith and knowledge of God has probably been more rewarding for me even than them. So once again, just to encourage you to be part of this ministry. Thank you.
My name is Bonghosi and I volunteer at the Children's Church. It's so exciting to see the children come to worship God and enjoy their time at the Children's Church, from the sign-in to the pre-games to the worship, where they just worship God with so much zeal and enthusiasm. I urge everyone to come and volunteer at the Children's Church as we further God's kingdom and we see the greats.
Hello everyone, my name is Rina. I'm a teacher at the Toddlers Bible Class. In Matthew chapter 19, verse 14 to 15, Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." So we as the Children's Church, together with our parents, Pastor Kevin and Pastor Helen, are on a mission to lead and guide our little ones to Christ. My experience as a toddler has been so, so amazing. And thank you, Potter's Wheel, for giving us such an opportunity. And to our parents, thank you so much for trusting us with your little ones. May God bless you all. Amen.
Amen and amen. So you are all encouraged to be a part of this wonderful ministry. You know, the Lord gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So let's start off with our children. Amen. Please do sign up. I promise you, you will have a wonderful experience. Now, last week we didn't have life groups and young adults meetings as usual because we had the Passover service and we had a wonderful time on Wednesday evening. But this coming Wednesday, we are back to having life groups. We're going to have a sermon-based study. So just want to encourage you, please come through, because it's important to dig deep into the Word and have a clear understanding and a deeper understanding, rich understanding of who God is in our lives and what He expects of us as we grow to become disciples of Jesus Christ. And on a rather sad note, just want to inform everybody that we, in the last week, we lost one of our brothers here at Potter's Wheel, Hersey Cross. And Hersey was part of the man-to-man prayer group. He was very dedicated, a lovely man, a wonderful man. And this coming Tuesday, we are going to be having his memorial service. So you're all encouraged to come through and celebrate the life of our dear brother. Amen. Now, before we get into the Word, we have a short clip, a video that we want to put up on the screen. But even before that clip plays on the screen, can we just pray for Pastor Kevin this morning for the Lord's blessing over his life? So Lord, we pray for Pastor Kevin, who's going to be sharing the Word this morning. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your blessing over his life. And we thank you for the Word that you have prepared and deposited in him. We pray that you speak through him and that you touch our lives through the Word that he's going to be sharing this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
He's risen indeed. Amen. Isn't it great to know that Jesus is alive and he's risen for you and I? And you know, Helen and I had the privilege of traveling to the US and going and seeing our son and our daughter-in-law, Joshua and Caroline, and their beautiful baby, our granddaughter. So for the first time, I'm in a mkulu. Can you believe it? We had the privilege of dedicating Stevie Joy, and she is a beautiful baby. And just have a look at this collage. This is the longest time we've ever been away from the church, Potter's Wheel. And so Helen and I, that's the day that we're leaving, so you can see the tears there. And we have this beautiful time of holding Stevie Joy and then walking with Joshua and then, of course, meeting with Pastor Stan and Dayton. It was a great time, and the ministry team did a fantastic job here. So let's just give them an applause. Thank you, team. Now, as I share with you the time that we've had in the U.S., what hit me was, as Joshua and Caroline's baby, Stevie Joy, our granddaughter, she's about 4 or 5 weeks old, and it's that time of having milk, sleeping, changing nappies. Having milk, sleeping, changing nappies. Does anyone remember that phase? You know, as we're in that place, it was just wonderful to watch our son Joshua really just love Stevie Joy. And no matter how many nappies he had to change, maybe 20 nappies in a day, but no matter how many nappies he had to change, he just loved on Stevie Joy. The father's love for their daughter. And as I stood as a grandfather watching, I was so loving Stevie Joy, but also Joshua and Caroline. And I share that with you to say that, do you know that Jesus didn't have to go to the cross? Think about that for a moment. He chose to go to the cross because of his love for us. And maybe you came to church this morning feeling, but I've got a dirty nappy. Maybe you feel like, how can God love me when I'm always whining and crying? And maybe you feel like you're in the phase of drinking milk, sleeping, and having nappies changed. But I want to assure you that Jesus loves you so much that changing your nappy is not an issue for him. Amen. Just as it wasn't an issue for Joshua or for me or for Helen to change nappies, God chose you before you were born. He loves you. He loves you so much that the resurrection power that raised Christ from the dead is available to you. Can you say with me, resurrection power? Resurrection. And this morning, because it is Resurrection Day and we celebrate Resurrection Day, I want to pick up on John chapter 20, going through the resurrection power, because I really believe some of you have arrived in church with your lives being imploded. Maybe you've got relational issues, maybe you've got financial issues, maybe you've got health issues, and life isn't working the way you want it to work. Maybe it feels like your life is imploding, that this nappy is a big nappy, and you need a miracle, you need help. But I wanted to point to you that many people feel like their lives are imploding, and it's not just buildings that implode. Just watch this for a moment as this building goes. You know, when lives implode, dreams implode, maybe education implodes. I don't know if you saw on the news recently the ship that was cargo ship that was going into Baltimore and how it lost power and suddenly it imploded and it knocked down a bridge with cars on top of it and lives imploded literally as they died at the bottom of the ocean there. And maybe this morning you feel like your life is imploding. Well, I want to put it to you that the disciples in John 20 felt like their lives were imploding. I want you to concentrate a little bit on a few characters, one of them being Simon Peter. Simon Peter, remember, he's just denied Christ 3 times. He thought he was so strong that he would never deny Christ, that he's ready to go to the cross, he's ready to die with Jesus. And then he denies Christ 3 times before the crucifixion. Not only does he deny Christ, but he denies Christ to a servant, a slave, not a person with power. And he denies Christ quickly. It doesn't take much time. He immediately denies Christ. And here's Peter thinking that his vision is that the Romans are going to get kicked out and he's going to become one of the leaders of Jerusalem, not just Jerusalem, by the way, Israel, that he's part of this group of people that are kicking out these guys and becoming the powerhouses to raise up Jerusalem and Israel to a powerhouse nation once again, a world leader. Maybe you feel like the vision that you've had has been imploding. Peter's had. He has denied Jesus and Jesus has gone to the cross. He's watched Jesus on the cross. His rabbi, his teacher, who he thought would restore Israel to him to lead, is suffering persecution on the cross and dies. His vision has imploded. His dream has imploded. And so in John 20, Magdalene went to the tomb early whilst it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter. Tell your neighbor, Simon Peter. And to the other disciple, and the other disciples, John, to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." I mean, this is a confusing time. Can you imagine how Peter's trying to work this out? The dream's imploded, now the body's stolen. I can imagine Simon Peter trying to work out what Jesus said on the cross. You know, there's these seven famous sayings, and amongst them, I won't repeat them all, but amongst them, Jesus is on the cross and he's been shouted at, reviled, tortured, he's bleeding, he's in pain, in his agony. These are the Romans that he despises. And Jesus says this, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." Can you imagine how confusing that is to Simon Peter? "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." You want us to forgive these Romans? You want us to forgive the Sanhedrin Council? You want us to forgive the Pharisees when they've taken our nation in the wrong direction? Maybe that's where you're at now. Maybe you're sitting in a place where you feel things are going in the wrong direction and the people are being mean and they're corrupt and taking things in the wrong direction. And the Lord is saying this morning, "And Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Think about this thing. He says, today, he says to the thief, he says to the thief next to him, "Today you will see me in paradise." How confusing is that? This guy is... Has he believed? Where's your doctrine on this? "Today you will see me in paradise." You mean there's hope? The confusion. And then he says, "Tetelestai." In three words in English, "It is finished, it is paid for." And darkness covered the face of the earth, and Jesus is separated from Father God, and he shouts out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And then he says, "It is finished. It's fully paid for." I can imagine Simon Peter standing there trying to work out what's going on. And then Jesus on the cross says this, "Father, I commit my spirit into your hands. Into your hands I commit my spirit. I give myself to you." He's nailed to the cross. He's tied to the cross. Someone doesn't take Jesus' life. Jesus gives his life. "Father, I commit my spirit into your hands." And I imagine Peter's trying to work this out because Peter was believing that he was strong. He could do things in his own strength. He'd said, I'll go with you to death. I can do this. I can do this. So he's battling with what has happened. Now Mary's brought this report. In verse 4, the scripture continues. And so they both ran together. That's John and Simon Peter. And the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. Now, just I want to share something here. John was much younger than Peter. That's why John could outrun Peter. And Peter came a little bit. I feel like that when I'm jogging. You know, these young guys. Yesterday I had this Pastor Majaha from Jesus Calls Worship Center. He's so young. And he's running way ahead of me. And I'm coming as the old man behind. This is Peter walking behind. And John has outrun him. And as we see this, we see that verse 5, he stooped down, looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there. Yet he didn't go in. John didn't go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. And he saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head. Not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together. Tell your neighbor, folded together. And you see, it's in a place by itself, and there's a special meaning to that because in Passover, Jesus folded the napkin of what's called the afikoman, where the matzah, the mediator, is put into this and it's folded. And the sign is, I'm coming back again. It's also a symbol for an expression for it is finished, it is paid for. And so Jesus had his napkin, his head cloth folded at the bottom as a sign of, I'm coming, it's finished. Tell your neighbor, it is finished. It is finished. So the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also and saw and believed. So John went in, saw and believed. It doesn't say Peter instantly believed. It says John. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again to their own homes. I share this because John saw and believed. He realized he is risen. Let me say again, he's risen. I say he is risen, you say he's risen indeed. That's what the disciples said. He is risen.
He is risen
indeed. Amen. But what does this resurrection mean to us? Because Jesus didn't pick up the weight of sin to only be a role model for us. Yes, he is a role model. He said, deny yourselves, pick up the cross and follow me. He is a role model. He's the best role model. He's the only role model we should have in our lives. But he didn't do it just to be a role model. He did it for far more than that. He became a curse to break the curse, to break sin over every single human being, over every generation for the whole world, so that you and I could have resurrection power. So what does it mean to have resurrection power in our lives? Let's consider 5 points as we look at John 20. First, resurrection means Jesus paid the price for all our sin. Peter thought that he had the strength to break through. Jesus warned him that he doesn't. In fact, that his grace is sufficient, that God's grace is sufficient. Listen to Paul as he says in 2 Corinthians 5:19, for God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. This is a beautiful part. Look at this. Could you say with me up the emphasis out loud, please? No longer counting people's sin against them. I just want you to think about this. Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sin against them. That's incredible. No longer counting sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. Look at verse 21. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we would be made right with God through Christ. Just bear with me for a moment. Jesus is the Word. He's the water of the Word. He not only took sin onto him, he gave us resurrection power to wash us consistently, continually, ongoing from all sin. You know, I don't know about you, but I find living in this life, I get dirty quickly. And I'm not talking about physical dirt of dust or dust storms. I'm talking about spiritual dirt. You open a newspaper and there's just gossip that comes out. You turn on the news and there's just defamation all over the place. You open Facebook and something smacks you with gossip or some slander or something you don't want to see just comes out. You turn on the television to watch a movie that you think is going to be clean, and a few seconds into it, it's not clean. It just sticks to you. How many of you recognize that this world is dirty and that we get dirty quickly? Well, I wanted to show you, not only did Jesus take our sin away, he gave us the ability to walk in his complete cleaning. Look at Zechariah chapter 13, verse 1. He prophesies that in that day, talking about today, that's today, talking about you today, in that day, a fountain, tell your neighbor, a fountain shall be opened for the house of David. He's talking about the community of the redeemed believers. He's talking about the church. He's talking about us. And that for the inhabitants of Jerusalem, for sin and for cleanliness, for sin and cleanliness. In other words, Jesus shed his blood and shed water, because he's the water of the word, to wash us not just of sin, but he gives us a fountain to wash away our uncleanliness. Resurrection power means this. Resurrection power means that he forgives us our sin and cleanses us. You have the ability to walk in the cleansing blood of the Lamb. There's therefore now no condemnation for us. And I share that because many of us are just like Simon and Peter. Simon Peter, I believe many of us this morning, maybe you're a businessman. Simon Peter was a fisherman, a businessman. And he got caught into the world or the worldly thinking. Maybe you're in ministry and ministry pulls you down. And it doesn't matter, but many of us are really like Simon Peter, wanting things to go our way, our vision, our purpose, our plan, and suddenly that vision, that purpose, that plan implodes. And many of us are thinking about, well, is it my sin that caused this? And I want to put it to you, the resurrection power comes to release us from all sin and give us the ability to be washed continually. Tell your neighbor, continually. Not just once, just continually. Jesus tasted death once for all mankind. He on the cross says, it's finished, tetelestai, I've paid it, it's done. But he doesn't stop there. Resurrection power means that Christ makes us righteous. Think about this. When Jesus was born, Mary, the mother of Jesus, embraced him. She was a righteous woman. She embraced him. When Christ was raised from the dead and the stone was rolled away, he stepped out and the first person that Jesus revealed himself to was Mary Magdalene. I want you to think about it. If you think that men should be in ministry, can I just warn you, it's men and women. Jesus revealed himself first to Mary. Not just Mary, but Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene came from the area called Magdala. And Magdala was well known in that time as the red light district, a very busy red light district, a very busy area of prostitution. I'm not saying she was a prostitute, although many theologians have said that she came from that background. I'm not saying that. But I am saying that definitely, scripturally, the Bible shows us that she had seven demons kicked out of her by Jesus. Jesus healed her of seven demons. Tell your neighbor, seven demons. Now, Jesus, when he was born the first time, Mary, his mother, embraced her. But the second time that he came out alive, out of the tomb, the first person to embrace him was Mary Magdalene. And I share that because resurrection power means that Jesus makes us righteous. Mary Magdalene was moved from the person who was healed of seven demons with a history that her surname becomes, that she, her reference becomes, she's Mary from Magdala, Mary Magdalene. And yet Jesus not only is embraced by her, but Jesus sends her with a ministry function because he made her righteous. Look at John 20, verse 15. Jesus said to Mary, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" She, supposing him to be the gardener, said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary, Mary." Just amazing how Jesus is, he's in the process of the ascension. The stone has been rolled away. The stone of sin, the stone of iniquity is rolled away. He's got this function to go into heaven, to ascend into heaven at this point in time. But he's not so busy, even in his ascension, that he pauses because he recognizes Mary is distraught and Mary is confused. This morning, you might be distraught, you might be confused, but Jesus knows that, and Jesus is here with you. He pauses and he calls your name out. He loves you. Don't worry about the dirty nappy. God isn't bothered by your dirty nappy. He loves you. Tell your neighbor, he really loves you. And so Mary, Mary, he says her name, she turned and said to him, "Rabboni," because she had learned to hear the voice of the Lord. Jesus says that he's speaking, my sheep will know my voice. Jesus said to her, don't cling to me, don't embrace me, don't hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but I go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending. But you go to my brethren, and you say to them, I'm ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God. I mean, resurrection power means that God gives us his righteousness. He restores us into right relationship. And that relationship reminds us that you have a calling and you have gifts. And the gifts of God and the calling of God are irrevocable. This morning, you might feel like Mary, you might feel like Peter, Simon Peter. Can I remind you, the calling of God and the gifts of God are irrevocable. Look at Romans 5, verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Much more those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. Mary was sent as a minister. Minister means to serve. Mary Magdalene was sent by Jesus, embraced by Jesus, and sent by Jesus to go and minister the word to the disciples, to Simon Peter, to John, to all the disciples. Isn't that incredible? She was sent to minister. I pray this morning that you will receive the grace, because at this point in time, Simon Peter still hasn't received the grace, and many of us haven't received the grace. We know mentally about the grace of God, but we haven't received the grace. Simon Peter's confused. He's trying to work it out. Maybe you feel like you're confused trying to work it out, but let me give you another point. Resurrection means Jesus joins us in our everyday life. He's here. He's omnipresent. God is omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent. Some of us have made bad choices, and you maybe feel like Jesus isn't with you. Peter felt like he had betrayed Jesus, and he felt like he'd rejected Jesus. He's living in condemnation. Judas himself had betrayed Jesus. The sad part of Judas is, even though Judas knew who Jesus was, Judas isolated himself from the disciples. He separated himself. And a brother who isolates himself rages against all wisdom and seeks his own desire. Can I challenge you? Do not isolate yourself from the body of Christ, because Satan's attacks are real. Oppression is real. Judas was living in condemnation and isolated himself. And because of that, he allowed his suicidal thoughts to plague him, and eventually he committed suicide. And I noticed in Eswatini, we have a problem with suicide. Have you noticed that in the news? We have a problem, and the problem is that we isolate ourselves and we allow the oppression. Satan has come to steal, kill, and destroy, but God has sent Jesus that he might give us life, not just life, abundant life. And the way we get life is we receive the forgiveness of sins. We receive his righteousness, and we recognize that Jesus joins in us in our everyday life. Look at John 20, verse 19. What's happened is the disciples are living in fear. They're really plagued with fear, because they fear that the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin council would come and persecute them. They recognize the Sanhedrin council and the Pharisees, the Jews, are angry with the disciples. And so the disciples, after seeing the brutal torture of Jesus, they go and hide themselves in their house and shut the door. They're terrified. They're living in fear. Tell your neighbor, they're living in fear. Even Simon Peter is living in fear. He's confused. The fear of man is a snare. Verse 19 says, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." And I speak over you this morning that the peace of Jesus be with you. Peace be with you. Tell your neighbor, peace be with you. They're still afraid. I mean, imagine if somebody stepped through the wall in your house and said, "Peace be with you." They were terrified. Even though it was Jesus, they were terrified. Look at verse 20. When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Only then the disciples were glad when they saw it was the Lord. So Jesus first had to show him his hands and the side before. Then they got glad. And then they had peace because they were living in fear. So many of us are living in fear, so much fear, that even when Jesus is talking to us, we don't receive what he's saying. You can't hold fear and faith at the same time. Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you." And even though they're in this place, as he says, "As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he'd said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit." There's a big thing this morning I believe the Lord is saying is, he's saying, "Receive my forgiveness." He's saying, "Receive my righteousness." He's saying, "Receive my peace. Receive my Holy Spirit." But you have to receive it. I remember that as a young Christian, I used to have a little book. In this little book I had, I would write down the sins that I'd committed. I was very glad no one else got to see my book. But I would walk with this little book and write down all my sins that the Lord reminded me. And the reason why is, and I'm sharing this for a reason, because you might be in that same place. As I wrote it down in the book, I would also write the date I confessed that sin. And I would write down the date I received forgiveness. Because once I'd received the forgiveness, the next time I had a thought, "Hey, Kevin, you messed up on that," I'd say, no, "I've asked for forgiveness. It's covered by the blood." Some of us have to receive and learn to receive forgiveness. Learn to receive the grace of God. Learn to receive his righteousness. Learn to receive his Holy Spirit. And because the Holy Spirit is there, know this. Jesus joins us in our everyday life. He's with you. And he's for you. So I say to you this morning, peace to you, as Jesus said. As the Father has sent me, he also sends you. And then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Resurrection power is available to you, for you, but also to flow through you. That's why he sends them, not just for you, but through you to others. Here's another one. Fourth one is, the resurrection power means Jesus intercedes for you. You have an intercessor praying for you, and his name is Jesus. Isn't that amazing? You know, Helen and I learned quickly that if we were going to walk in this life of ministry and we were going to do radically whatever God told us to do, we needed people to stand with us and pray with us. And so we have a small group of intercessors that we send messages to and ask them to pray for us. But we have an even better intercessor. We're very grateful for the intercessors because when one prays, 1,000 are put to flight. But when two pray together, 10,000 are put to flight. Amen? The Lord says, where two or three agree on a matter, it shall be done. Tell your neighbor, it shall be done. So intercessors are important. And if you haven't got a group of people praying for you, arise and shine. Find some intercessors and get them to start praying with you and for you as you enter into things. When we flew to the U.S., we were saying, please pray for Joshua and Caroline and pray for Stevie Joy. We need intercessors, but we've also got the best intercessor, Jesus. He's praying for us. Look at Romans 8, verse 34. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore, is also risen, who's even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Yo, you've got Jesus sitting at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you. Right now, you might feel like Simon Peter, you're on your own. Jesus is praying for Simon Peter at that time, and he's praying for you. Tell your neighbor, Jesus is praying for you. Look at Luke 22 on Simon Peter. This is before the crucifixion. I love this story. Jesus says to Simon Peter, he says, Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you. And here's the news. Jesus is praying for you too, that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. This is really crucial. Could you just say with me, when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. Jesus was warning him that he was going to go on the wrong path. The word returned is actually the word convert. When you've converted back to me, when you've returned to me, Jesus knew that Peter would go on the wrong path because he's God. Not only is he God, but he recognized pride in Peter. Look at for a moment at the pride in Peter. He says in verse 33, but Peter said, Lord, I'm ready to go with you both to prison and to death. Peter had a pride problem. How many of you would agree that you've got a pride or a shame problem? I'll put up my hand. Only a few. Just let me give you a second opportunity. Father, in the name of Jesus. How many of you agree you've got a pride problem? For those of you who didn't put up your hand, I want to lay hands on you afterwards. Just stay behind. Peter had a pride problem, and many of us are just like Peter. And we think that we can do it in our own strength. And you know what? So many of us have got our own plan. Plan A, plan B, plan C. And Peter had his own plan, but his plans imploded. And Jesus had warned him. He knew that. And Jesus knows that for you. He knows the issues that you're facing. He knows you. He knows your dirty nappies. That's why it's so beautiful in John 21. I won't take you there, but in John 21, after the resurrection, in John 21, Peter is still confused and he goes fishing. And out fishing the whole night, he catches nothing. His business is not working. His dream is imploded. And Jesus is on the shore. He's already got a fire going. He's got a barbecue. It's a fish barbecue. He's having a barbecue there. And he calls out to the disciples. He says to the disciples, have you caught anything? Knowing they haven't. They said, no, nothing all night. He says, throw the net the other side. And so they throw the net the other side. They get a huge catch. Sure. They haul in the catch. Peter realizes this is Jesus. So he jumps overboard. He swims furiously with a crawl, freestyle approach right to the shore. Gets up to Jesus, and he sees Jesus on the shore. The fish is already there. They've caught fish, but the fish is already there. God has already met your needs. He knows where you're going. And then he turns around, and you know the question. He asked Peter three times, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And then he says to Peter, tend my lambs, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. Because Peter's returned. Today, I believe, is a day that many need to return. That God is calling you. You might have been like Simon Peter, and you're off on your own vision, and you thought your vision was God's vision because it's your vision, therefore it's God's vision. And so your world is imploded. The building is imploded. The life is imploded. The relationship is imploded. The health is imploded. God came to give you resurrection life. The same power that raised Christ from the dead is available to you. It means that you are forgiven, that you have righteousness, that Jesus is with you. And it means that he's praying for you. He's interceding for you. Resurrection also means the resurrection power is available to us. This is the final one. Look at Ephesians 1, verse 19 again. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe? Sorry, say with me, us who believe. You see, John ran into the tomb and he saw that the cloth was there and he believed. Peter was still battling. And the Lord said to Peter, Peter, when you return to me, when you understand and you return to me. Many of us know in our heads that we forgive it, know in our heads that we have righteousness, know in our heads that Jesus is praying for us, know in our heads that God is with us, he's omnipresent, but in our hearts it feels like things aren't right. the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead, and he seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. In other words, that same power is available to you. In John 20, verse 20, let's look again. When he saw this, he showed them his hands and his side, and his disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." I want to put it to you that the resurrection power is available to us, for us, and through us. And so Simon Peter was told, "Return to me, receive the Holy Spirit," and then Jesus sends him to feed the lambs, tend the lambs, and feed the sheep, to strengthen his brethren. The Sunday morning, Resurrection Sunday. Resurrection means the following. It means Jesus paid the price for my sin, for our sin. It's time to recognize your name as it's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Resurrection means Jesus makes us righteous by the gift of righteousness. It's a gift, not by works. Resurrection means Jesus joins us in our everyday life. Resurrection power means that Jesus intercedes for us, and that resurrection power is available to us in Jesus' name. Can I invite the worship team up, and can I ask you to stand this morning? Because there's a strong sense in my spirit that across the room this morning, I just feel that many people in this room feel like they've got dirty nappies. And maybe you feel like your nappy is just too dirty. And maybe you feel like Peter, confused. Maybe you feel like Mary Magdalene, and you've got this history of 7 demons in the past that Jesus has healed you from, but you don't feel ready yet. And yet the Lord says, the same power that raised Christ from the dead is available to you. And I believe today, on Resurrection Sunday, he's calling you to take your place, to receive his blessing, that your sins are forgiven, that you are righteous in Christ, to recognize Jesus is with you, to recognize you have an intercessor, and to recognize his power is available to you to overcome. Can I ask you just to close your eyes for a moment? And as you do, we recognize how much we need grace. Holy Spirit, we welcome you this morning. We admit that, like Peter, we've been confused, and life hasn't turned out the way we thought it should. We had plans. We ask you for forgiveness for being disappointed, offended, that our plans didn't come about. But today, we come back to you, we return to you like Peter, and we ask you that your plans, your will, be done in our lives. We recognize that even your son in the Garden of Gethsemane, he asked you, if you're willing, if there's another way, nevertheless, not my will be done, your will be done. And Lord, I lift up your sons and daughters in this house, and I thank you for this beautiful family, this wonderful church, this loving church, this potential church, filled with God's potential. I lift them up before you, and I ask, Lord, that you would touch the hearts of those who feel like Peter, those who feel like Mary, those who feel like Judas, those who feel like Thomas, maybe doubting, that they would be able to realign to you today, to come back and receive your revelation of your calling, of your assignment, the stirring of the gifts of the Spirit that you've placed in them, in Jesus' name. I pray, Father, for your anointing to come upon each one this morning, that the heaviness of confusion would leave in the name of Jesus, that the spirit of fear that has held people back from loving you well, lift off, that the spirit of tradition, traditional religion, religion that shapes the Pharisees and the scribes, that they couldn't even recognize Jesus, that that spirit of tradition and religion that blocks you from moving would leave us. And we welcome you, Holy Spirit, to come in and fill us in Jesus' name. Amen. Just with your eyes closed, if you recognize this morning that we need God's grace more than words can say, and you recognize you've been like Peter, this morning you want to come back to the Lord and realign to the Lord, that His calling, that His will come upon your life, that He use you to strengthen the brethren in your workplace, in your community, wherever you work. If that's you this morning, and if you recognize you've been like Peter, can I ask you just to put up your hand? Just confess it to the Lord. Can you just put up your hand? In Jesus' name. Father, you see the hands that are before you. We invite you, Father, to fill us with your Spirit. In Jesus' name. Father, I pray your blessings over your sons and daughters as they put up their hands. In Jesus' name. Amen. He is risen. A little louder. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
As we go into this time of worshiping the Lord, if you feel like you've really been at a distance from the Lord Jesus and you need to recalibrate to Him, as Peter did, I'm going to ask you not to allow pride or shame to hold you back. I come up to this altar so many times kneeling before God. As we go into a time of worship, can I ask you just to step out and kneel before the Lord and allow God's gifts to fill you, His calling to be reawakened. Because He's called you. He's forgiven you. He's given you righteousness. He's with you. He's interceding for you, that His power might flow in you, through you, for others. In Jesus' name.
I come, Jesus, I come. I will rise, stand. Lord Jesus.
Of us, can I ask that we take a seat and prepare our minds to enjoy communion with God and with each other? There is a passage that I'd like to read from Luke chapter 22, beginning at verse 14. It says, "When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God.'" And we're looking at from the other side of this passage, and we're recognizing that after he suffered, he rose again from the dead. And here's what we're celebrating today. We're celebrating the fact that just as much as Jesus knew that there was going to be an activity that he's engaged in after his suffering and after his death, we're celebrating the life of God and that we can be a part of his body. So those of you who do not have communion elements, if you would like to partake of the Holy Communion, please raise your hand and somebody will make sure that you get that. Let's just pray together. Father, we do want to thank you that we are a part of your body, and we thank you that your body was broken for us so that we could have life. We thank you for the forgiveness of sins and that we can be your righteousness, and that you give us the gift of your Holy Spirit, and you give us a powerful ministry that we need to be reconciling people to you. But Father, we just thank you for the reconciliation that we have with you in Jesus' name. Amen. In verse 20, he says, "In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.' And I think as we think about that, as we think about this new covenant, as we think about those words of Jesus when he says, whenever you do this in remembrance of me. As we remember the good new covenant that God has made available to us in his blood, that it comes with forgiveness of sins and continual cleansing of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we have to give thanks. Father, we are just so grateful to you for the way in which you love us, the demonstration, the extreme demonstration of that love. We thank you for the forgiveness of our sins, and we thank you for a whole new relationship. We thank you for the love that you pour into our hearts through your Spirit. And Father, I pray that as you have blessed us, that we can be a blessing as we have communion with each other and with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Can I ask if you can rise and shine? For your light has come. And I say that with real love in my heart, that God is pouring out his joy, his love on you. I want to go back to thinking about how Joshua is holding our granddaughter, his daughter, in his hands. And she's drinking milk, sleeping, changing nappies. Drinking milk, sleeping, changing nappies. And yet the love of the Father is to smile upon that child. You know, I walked in the early morning because Joshua had taken the Stevie Joy at 3 a.m, was holding the baby in the morning in the lounge. And so I got down because of the time zone. I got down at 4 a.m. just to sit there and pray, and found Joshua sitting there singing over his daughter. Scripture in Zephaniah says that God sings over us. God dances over us. His love never gives up on us. He never gave up on Peter, and he's not giving up on you. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And I ask you to turn to your neighbor and say, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you forevermore. May the resurrection power of God flow in you and through you. God bless you.
Risen, he's risen forever.